everyone. I'm Dr. Rizwana, working as a professor of physics in Institute of Aeronautical Engineering. Today in this video, I'm going to discuss about one special type of semiconductor device. And that special type of semiconductor device is our light emitting diode, which is simply called as LED. So this is light emitting diode, which is simply called as LED. And of course, this light emitting diode, it will come under category of optoelectronic device. This light emitting diode, it will come under category of optoelectronic device. And in this device, of course, here we can say that this LED can be taken as one like sensor, or also it can be taken as one transducer, which is going to convert one form of energy to another form. So here when we are talking about this particular light emitting diode, here exactly our input will be electrical energy and our output will be our light energy. And this light emitting diode is completely opposite to photodiode. There is one more optoelectronic device, which is photodiode. And this working of photodiode is completely like contradictory or opposite to this light emitting diode. Photodiode, what it will do, its input will be light and output will be current, whereas in case of light emitting diode, our input will be electrical energy, which is in the form of current, and our output will be light. And coming to their biasing of diode is also different, and type of material used in order to make LED as well as photodiode is different. So today first we'll see what exactly is our LED. But first, just when we talk about our PN junction, what is the symbol of our PN junction diode? We know that usually PN junction diode, it is represented by one triangle, which is P type of PN junction. And then we have one vertical line, which is represented by N type of PN junction. And this is a positive end of PN junction. This is negative end of junction. And in my previous video, I have discussed about different types of biasing of PN junction. And whereas when we are talking about light emitting diode, we'll focus more we are focusing on only one type of biasing, which is forward biasing. So if we try to recollect what exactly is forward biased PN junction diode. So when we talk about forward biased PN junction diode, so we know that once we take our PN junction, so this is our P type, P side of PN junction, and this is N side of PN junction. So this is P side and this one is N side of PN junction. And in P side we have holes, and whereas in N side we have electrons. So here we have holes and here we have electrons. And this P region and N region, they have depletion layer. So this is our depletion layer. And in this depletion layer, we have immobile charge carriers. So we know that first when we form PN junction, because of diffusion of charge carriers, some of the electrons from inside, they migrate to P side. And once these electrons come to P side, they'll become neutral, or they'll recombine with holes here. And here we have accumulation of negative ions. So we can also call them as P-type negative ions, or we can also call as immobile negative ions, or negative ions which do not take part in conduction. And similarly here holes, what they'll do, because of diffusion, they'll migrate to N side and then onto the N, like in the junction layer, if you take it towards the N side, these holes, when they go to N side, they lose their energy or they combine with electrons there. And they are generally referred as N-type positive ions, or we can also say these are the holes without any energy. So here we have accumulation of electrons and holes which do not take part in conduction. They don't have any energy. So this is about our depletion layer. Now when we have such a PN junction, and what we are going to do here, we are going to forward bias this PN junction. So what exactly is forward biasing of PN junction? Where P type of PN junction, it is connected to positive terminal of battery, and N type of PN junction, it is connected to negative terminal of battery. So this is forward biased PN junction diode. So this is called as forward biased PN junction diode. So what is forward bias p-n junction diode, where p type of p-n junction it is connected to positive terminal of battery, and inside of p-n junction it is connected to negative terminal of battery. And we know that once we forward bias p-n junction, then width of the depletion layer it is going to decrease. And we have seen in the VI characteristics of p-n junction, suppose if we try to take voltage on x-axis, suppose I have used variable external voltage, if we take voltage on x-axis and if we measure current along the y-axis, then what we'll observe here is slowly what happens to this width of depletion layer it is going to decrease, and there exists one particular voltage called as knee voltage, threshold voltage or cut-in voltage, where there is sudden rise in current. So and after this point, which is threshold voltage, as you can see, large amount of current flowing across the junction. Then what exactly is happening? Why there is decrease in the width of depletion layer during forward biasing? So as you can make out that in p-type we have holes, in n-type we have electrons. Now these holes are positively charged, so they suffer repulsion from positive terminal of battery, and where they'll move, they'll start moving towards the depletion layer. And similarly, when we take electrons in inside, they'll suffer repulsion from negative terminal of battery and they'll start moving towards the depletion layer. So here holes in P side and electrons in inside, because they are suffering repulsion from battery. So what they'll do, they'll start moving towards the depletion layer. Okay. Now, of course, we said that when we have discussed about biasing of p-n junction, we are completely talking in terms of current flowing across the diode. So we have seen that during forward biasing, or when we have discussed about VI characteristic of diode, so there exists one voltage, threshold voltage. After this, what happens to current? There is large amount of current flowing. Why? Because these electrons, because they are suffering repulsion from this negative terminal, what they'll do, they'll cross over the junction layer and they'll try to come towards the positive terminal of battery. Similarly, holes, they will cross this junction layer and they'll get attracted towards the negative terminal of battery. So that's why width of depletion layer will decrease. So that is because these immobile charge carriers, they'll start moving under the action of this polarity. So that's why width of depletion layer takes place. This is what we have discussed when we have taken biasing of p-n junction. But when we talk about this light emitting diode and when we talk about forward biasing of p-n junction, there is one important phenomena taking place, and that phenomena, it takes place during forward biasing of diode, and that phenomena, it is called as recombination of electron hole pairs. So actually there are two processes associated with these semiconductors. First process, it is called as generation of electron hole pair. So when we talk about this, we have generation of electron hole pair, and then we have one more process which is called as recombination of electron hole pair. So one process is generation, another process is recombination. So coming to this recombination of electron hole pair, so what exactly is generation of electron hole pair? In generation of electron hole pair, if we try to explain in terms of these bands, we know that EC represents the bottommost energy level of conduction band, and EV represents topmost energy level of valence band. And in generation of electron hole pair, we have first electrons in the valence band. So these are the electrons without any energy, or simply we can call them as valence electrons. Now when I supply energy, when we supply energy to these valence electrons in valence band, they'll take energy. And then what happens to these electrons? These electrons, they will get excited to conduction band. Okay, so once these electrons make transition to this conduction band, as a result, what happens to this vacant electron site? It will act as a hole. And then in conduction band, we have one free electron. So per transition, we are going to get one electron and hole. And this process is called as generation of electron hole pairs. But coming to recombination of electron hole pair, already we have our electron in conduction band. Already we have our electron in conduction band, and what do you mean by electron in conduction band? It means that this electron is a free electron which is taking part in conduction, And here this electron, it is in higher energy level, because we know that all the energy levels in conduction band, they represent energy levels, higher energy levels. And we know that each energy level, it is going to have its own lifetime. So lifetime of an energy level. Here we talk about lifetime of an energy level. So every energy level, it is going to have one lifetime. So after lifetime, what happens to that particle or atom which is present in that energy level? Then automatically that electron or particle or atom, it will start losing its energy spontaneously, and then it will try to come back to its ground state. And during recombination process, unlike generation, here we have release of energy. So here when this electron comes down after its lifetime spontaneously, so it is going to release energy. How much of energy is being released? Energy which is equal to this forbidden energy gap, which is nothing but difference between energy levels of bottommost energy level of conduction band and topmost energy level of valence band. And coming to this recombination process, one thing what we have to observe here is main phenomena which is going to play very important role in light emitting diode is recombination of electron hole pair. So here, as we can make out that because of repulsion from positive terminal of battery, these holes which are present in p-type of p-n junction, they are going towards the depletion layer. And similarly, here we are going to observe that electrons which are present in N-side, because they are suffering repulsion from negative terminal of battery, they will also go towards the depletion layer. Now, this electron and hole pair, they'll combine and they'll become neutral. So here, what we have to understand here is holes which are moving towards the depletion layer from P region, and electrons from N region which are also going towards the depletion layer. These holes and electrons, what they are going to do, they are going to become neutral, they are going to combine. So here we, that particular process, it is called as recombination. Recombination means where electron and hole, major if we talk in terms of electron, so mobile electron, it will become immobile, it will start losing its energy. Only if it starts losing energy, again it will gain energy from external voltage supply and will have electrons flowing across the junction. That's why we will have large current flowing under forward passing of diode. And here, as you can see here, as I told you, so if electrons and holes, if they recombine, which occurs during process of forward biasing of diode, which is nothing but electron from conduction band losing its energy spontaneously and coming down to valence band. And we know that during this process, energy is released. Whereas we have seen in generation here, we have to supply energy in order to make this electron in the valence band go to higher state. But in this case, electron, it is taking transition from higher state to lower state. So obviously, it is going to release energy. How much energy it is going to release? It is going to release energy which is equal to forbidden energy gap. So here, one thing we have learned here, what we have come to know here is, when we forward bias p-n junction, where p-type of p-n junction is connected to positive terminal of battery and n-type of p-n junction is connected to negative terminal of battery, apart from width of depletion layer being decreased, and at one particular voltage called as threshold voltage, where depletion layer gets completely eliminated, and there is flow of large current across the junction. Apart from this, one important point what we have to note down here is during forward biasing, because electrons and holes, they are moving towards the depletion layer, what happens to this electron hole pair? They'll recombine. So what exactly is this phenomenon of recombination of electron hole pair, where electron which is already mobile, which is with energy, it is going to lose its energy. So it will come down to valence band and it is going to release energy, and that energy is equal to this forbidden energy gap. Now, if I make this p-type and n-type, we know that this p-type semiconductor and n-type semiconductor, they belong to extrinsic semiconductors. So what are extrinsic semiconductors? In extrinsic semiconductors, we'll take intrinsic semiconductors like silicon and germanium, and to the silicon and germanium we'll add suitable dopants in order to make them p-type and n-type. So if I make p-type and n-type extrinsic semiconductors using normal elemental semiconductors. So what are elemental semiconductors? So the silicon and germanium, they'll come under category of elemental semiconductors. So semiconductors which belong to group 4, and also these are the materials which consists of single atoms or elements. So when I make this p-type and n-type materials of p-n junction using silicon or germanium, will observe that this difference between energies of EC and EV, it is equal to energy of heat. So that's why when recombination process takes place during forward biasing, here energy is released in the form of heat. But so what I'm doing here is I'm not making this p-n junction with normal diode. So when we talk about light emitting diodes, so it is a diode which has got p side and n side, but this diode, it is not made with normal intrinsic semiconductors like silicon and germanium, but it is made with some special type of semiconductors. So what exactly are these special type of semiconductors? Those special type of semiconductors, they are called as compound or direct bandgap semiconductors. So these semiconductors, they are called as compound or direct bandgap semiconductors. In my previous videos, I have discussed in detail about these semiconductors. So actually, if you talk about this silicon and germanium, they are naturally occurring semiconductors. Okay, and of course, if you take silicon crystal, it is made up of silicon atoms, single atoms. But when we talk about these compound semiconductors, they are artificially made. So man-made semiconductors, which are formed artificially. So these semiconductors are formed artificially, and how we are going to make them? By mixing different types of elements, and these elements, they are taken from different groups of periodic table. Okay, and our intention is, our whole and sole intention is, I want to make a semiconductor. So why we are doing all this? Why, if I have silicon and germanium, then why I have to make artificial semiconductors like compound semiconductors? My intention is, when I go for this in a forbidden energy gap, which is difference between energy level of conduction band and valence band, I want to make this forbidden energy gap or this value of energy, it should be equal to energy of photon. So my whole and sole intention is to make this energy difference equal to energy of photon. So that, as I have discussed, during forward biasing of diode, during recombination, energy will be released. If I make use of normal silicon and germanium, energy is released in the form of heat. But if I select, if I am able to make semiconductor, and if in that semiconductor, if this energy difference, it is equal to forbidden energy gap, then during recombination, when your electron is coming down from conduction band to valence band, here when it starts releasing energy, that energy it will come out in the form of photons. And all these photons, they are going to give us light. So what is my output? Output is nothing but my light. And what is my input? I am forward biasing a diode. It means that I am supplying electrical energy. Then how to make this forbidden energy gap equal to energy of photon? So for that, what I have to do, I have to select combinations of certain types of elements. So if we clearly see this particular diagram, it will help us to understand better which elements are combined together in order to form compound semiconductors where forbidden energy gap, it is equal to energy of photon. And of course, these compound semiconductors, they are also called as direct bandgap semiconductor, where electron from conduction band directly recombines with hole in valence band. So directly recombines with hole in valence band, and here lifetimes of recombination, time taken for electron to come down or to recombine with hole in valence band, it will be very, very small. And this is a direct recombination. What is indirect recombination? Where electron, it won't come directly to its original vacant site, but it will get trapped in a defect region. Then what happens? So it is made to stay in those traps for some time, and then it will come down. But when it comes down, it won't go to its original vacant electron site. So here their positions will not match. So here direct recombination process takes place. So in order to have this forbidden energy gap equal to energy of photon, so what we have to do? So when we talk about this compound semiconductor, so if I go for combination of elements, first combination is I'm going to select the element belonging to third group, and then one more element which is belonging to fifth group. And when we combine these two elements, I'm going to get direct bandgap semiconductor where forbidden energy gap, it is equal to energy of photon. And similarly, I can also go for next combination where I'm going to select element from second group, and then one more element from sixth group. And then coming to one more combination where I'm going to select two elements coming from same group, which is fourth group. And if you look at this periodic table, it will help me to understand what are the different materials that will come under direct band gap semiconductors. So if I take second group elements, I have taken zinc and cadmium. And when we talk about third group elements, I have taken boron, aluminium, gallium and indium. And then coming to this fourth group elements, we have carbon, silicon, germanium. And then of course, fifth group elements, nitrogen, phosphorus, arsenic, antimony. And then coming to sixth group, we have selenium and then tellurium. And when we go for this first combination, third and fifth elements. So here we are combining this third element and this fifth element. So if I take gallium from third and arsenic from fifth, which is very popular direct band gap semiconductor, gallium arsenide. Similarly, I'll have indium phosphide, or I'll go for gallium nitride. Or also I can combine second group and then this sixth group element. So in second group, I have zinc, and then in sixth group, I have sulfide, selenide or telenide. As you can see, zinc sulfide or zinc selenide. And whereas if I consider elements coming from the same group, which is the fourth group, I'll have silicon carbide and silicon germanide. And what is the specialty of all these materials? In all these materials, direct recombination takes place where electrons. So here when we talk about direct recombination, this is very one important point here. We are talking about direct recombination. In direct recombination, what we'll observe here is when we talk in terms of EK curve. So when we consider EK curve, so if this is our conduction band and if this is our valence band, and here we are taking this EK curve by taking on x-axis momentum vector K. So here we have taken this valence, different energy levels in conduction band and valence band with respect to momentum vector K. So if we consider it, then what we are going to observe here is this bottommost point in conduction band. Of course, we know that bottommost energy level in conduction band, it is represented by EC, and topmost energy level in valence band, it is represented by EV. And only in case of this direct band gap semiconductors or in direct recombination materials, suppose this point and this point, that is maximum value of K value of valence band and minimum K value of conduction band, they are same. Suppose if this is K1 and if this is K2, then K1 is equal to K2. And this process, it is said to be direct recombination. Direct recombination takes place. And one more thing, what we have to observe here is when electron comes down to valence band, here energy, it is released in the form of photons. This is about the materials which we are using in order to make LEDs. So when we are going for selection of suitable materials, so here LED light emitting diode, it's a forward bias diode. And then this diode, it is not made with normal intrinsic semiconductors like silicon and germanium, but it is made with some special type of semiconductors which are called as compound or direct band gap semiconductors. And also when we talk about nature of material, we'll observe that the energy gap, it should be proper width, or we can also talk it as where energy gap it is equal to H nu. And here we are going to observe here is both P-type and N-types. They must exist. These whatever materials we are selecting, they should have low resistivity. So such low resistive P-type and N-type semiconductors are used in order to form diode in light emitting diode. And of course, they should have efficient radiative pathways. And coming to different materials, as I have already discussed, so here different elements belonging to different groups are combined. So ultimately, here forbidden energy gap, it should be equal to H nu. And what is the process involved? Direct recombination. And how we are going to bias our light emitting diode? It is forward biasing. Now coming to construction of light emitting diode. So as you can make out this particular figure in our PPT. So here we have taken a PN junction diode. And using which method we are going to form this PN junction, usually we'll go for process called as diffused junction type. So in order to make LEDs, in order to form PN junction, which is used for light emitting diode. So what is the method in order to form PN junction? It is called as diffused junction type. What is diffused junction type? First, we'll take N-type wafer. As you can see down, we have N-type wafer. We'll take a thin layer of N-type material. And then this thin layer of is kept in very hot atmosphere. It is kept in furnace. And usually what temperature we are going to maintain? We are going to maintain 1000 degrees Celsius. And then we are going to expose this n-type wafer to gas of travelling impurities, that is boron atoms. Then what we'll observe here is these boron atoms, gas atoms, diffusion takes place. So these boron atoms, they'll come and they'll penetrate on the upper surface of this n-type wafer, making this upper surface p-type and this lower surface it is n-type. So usually which method we'll go? We'll go for diffused junction type. And once we form this p-type and n-type, that is nothing but once we form our p-n junction, we know that in p-type we have majority charge carriers holes, and in type we have majority charge carriers electrons. And we know that our LED is a forward bias diode. So that's why in order to go for forward biasing, as you can make out that in order to go, what is forward biasing, where if we take our diode, of course this is our diode, we know that p-type of diode, it is connected to positive terminal of battery, and n-type of diode is connected to negative terminal of battery. So here down, in order to go for cathode connection, so what we have done, I made use of gold film. So we have to give contacts in such a way that I should go for forward biasing of the diode. So in order to go for forward biasing, as you can see, bottom layer of n-type wafer, it is coated with gold film and it will act as cathode connection. And whereas if you go for top layer of p-type of p-n junction, it is coated with metal film so that I can go for anode connection. So here I am going for anode connection. In order to have anode connection, we are coating top layer of p-type with metal film, and then we are coating bottom layer of n-type with gold film in order to go for cathode connection. Why? Because we have to go for forward biasing. In forward biasing, we know that p-type, it is connected to positive terminal, and this n-type, it is connected to negative terminal of battery. So we have to select our contacts, okay, coatings to p-type and n-type layers of p-n junction in such a way that like whether we are going for reverse biasing or forward biasing. In this case, because we are going for forward biasing, what I have done, bottom layer of n-type, it is connected, like it is coated with gold film, whereas top layer, it is coated with metal film. And here if we carefully observe, as you can see, entire top layer of p-n junction or entire top layer of p-type, it is not covered with metal film, whereas small region, small central portion of this p-side, it is left open, so that when recombination takes place during forward biasing, of course we know that recombination takes place, and during recombination we know that energy is being released in the form of photons. So obviously we are going to get light, so we should be able to see our LED glow. So that light, it should come out of LED. So in order for the light emission, so we leave a small portion, central portion of this p-type layer, top layer of this p-n junction open, so that light can escape and we can see our LED glow. So this is about the construction, and here we can also see this phenomenon of recombination once we forward bias it. So holes from p-type, they'll go towards the n-type. Similarly, electrons from n-type, they'll go towards the p-type. And what is the process taking place? Recombination of charge carriers, where we have release of energy. Now, if we try to explain working of this light emitting diode using energy band diagram. So as you can see in this figure, this is the simple case of forward biasing, which I have already discussed. So here we have our p-type of p-n junction. This is our n-type of p-n junction. And of course, we have gone for forward biasing. And here, as you can make out those white spheres are our holes, whereas this red spheres, they are electrons. So these are our normal electrons and these are our holes, which are majority charge carriers in p-type, and whereas these red balls, they are electrons, which are majority charge carriers in n-side. And once we connect p-type to positive terminal and n-type to negative terminal, now as you can see that you will have migration of charge carriers, so electrons from n-side going into p-region. And similarly, holes from P side, they are going to N region, and you can make out here. What we are trying to show here, it is nothing but recombination of electron hole pair. So here, now electrons and holes, they are combining, they are becoming neutral. So here, recombination is taking place. And what happens to depletion region? Depletion region keeps on decreasing, and we know that during recombination energy it will be released. So here that energy, it is coming out in the form of photons. Why it is coming out in the form of photons? Because what type of material we have used in order to make this light emitting diode? Direct band gap semiconductors or compound semiconductors, where forbidden energy gap it is equal to energy of photon. And if we try to explain this process, and one more thing, coming to symbol of LED, we know that normal LED, it is given by this symbol where we have a triangle and one vertical line. This is P-type and N-type. Whereas when we go for symbol for LED, so this is our symbol for LED. Here also we have triangle followed by vertical line. This is P-type and N-type. But what is the difference between symbol for normal diode and light emitting diode? In light emitting diode, we have two arrows which are shown going outside. So it means that our output energy is lighter. And what is the input energy? Electrical energy. So if you are showing these two arrows going outside, so this particular representation is symbol for light emitting diode. And if we try to explain this light emitting diode using energy level diagram, so if we consider energy band diagram of PN junction diode, so if we consider energy band diagram of PN junction diode, so if we draw this energy band diagram, so if we take a P type of PN junction and if we take N type of PN junction, so here what we are going to do here is, suppose we know that in a P type of PN junction, of course when we talk about conduction and valence band, so we know that in a P type of PN junction, its conduction band, it is represented as ECP. What is ECP? Conduction band in P region of PN junction. And then we have EVP, which is valence band in P region of course, P region of PN junction. And we know that where will be the Fermi level in P-type? We know that Fermi level, it will be closer to valence band. So Fermi level will be closer to valence band. And whereas when we talk about N-type, and if we consider conduction band and valence band in N region of PN junction, always we'll take those conduction band and valence band in N region lower than the conduction band and valence band in P region. So here, so if you consider this, of course this is energy band diagram of PN junction, and this is conduction band in N region of PN junction, and this is valence band in N region of PN junction. And we know that in N-type semiconductor, where is the Fermi level? Fermi level, it will be close to conduction band. So once PN junction is formed, as you can observe here, is conduction band and valence band in P region, it will be little bit higher than the conduction band and valence band in N region, in such a way that what you will observe here is Fermi level, it will be common or it will be uniform throughout the PN junction. So here position of Fermi level, it will be same throughout the PN junction. And this is our depletion layer in PN junction. So this is energy band diagram of PN junction. So coming to this energy band diagram, as we have taken this energy, as you can make out in this figure also, we will try to draw it again. So this is conduction band and valence band in P region and also N region of PN junction diode. So you can make out that this is PN junction, this is conduction band and valence band in P region, and this is a conduction band and valence band in N region. This is an energy band diagram of PN junction diode. So this is energy band diagram of PN junction diode. So if you consider this, we know that Fermi level, it will become uniform toward the PN junction, and this is our depletion layer. And here if you talk about this, if suppose if this I take it as EFP, and if this I have taken as EFN, then what you are going to observe here is Fermi levels, they will be same, their positions will be same throughout the PN junction. Okay, but still, if you consider P side of PN junction, Fermi level, it will be close to valence band. And if you consider N side of PN junction, it will be close to conduction band. Okay, and one more thing, we know that in P region we have holes in the valence band which are majority charge carriers, and when we consider this N region, we have electrons which are present in the conduction band. So these are the majority charge carriers. And once we forward bias a PN junction, this figure, it represents unbiased PN junction layer where we don't have any charge carriers, mobile charge carriers in depletion layer. But once we forward bias PN junction, then what we are going to see here is, because they are suffering repulsion from terminals of the battery, so these electrons, they will start moving towards the depletion layer. Similarly, these holes also, they start moving towards the depletion layer. And here, because electrons and holes, they are coming in the depletion layer, they will become neutral. So what do you mean by becoming neutral? Now we have holes here, and here of course we have electrons here, and then of course holes, and these electrons, they'll undergo direct recombination. So what is the process taking place? Direct recombination, where electron, it will come back to its original vacant site. Okay. So, and lifetime of recombination is also very small. So what is direct recombination? Where this what we can make out here is, both minimum value of conduction band and maximum value of conduction band, they'll occur at same momentum vector k. So k1, it is equal to k2. So here, electron, it is going to lose energy, hole also it is going to lose energy, and because we are making them with special type of semiconductors called as direct band gap semiconductors, here energy, it is going to come out in the form of photons, because here energy gap, it is equal to h nu. So this energy gap is also equal to h nu. So that's why, what is the input I'm giving? I'm forward biasing diode. Okay, and what is the output I'm getting? Because of recombination, I'm getting my output in the form of light. So we can call this light emitting diode as optoelectronic device, whose input is electrical energy and whose output is light energy. So this is about the working of forward biased PN junction diode, and this is in terms of its energy band diagram. So if we consider, this is also one type of energy band diagram which will help us to understand the working of light emitting diode. As you can make out, this is a p-type, p region of PN junction, this is N region, and of course this is conduction band in p region of PN junction, this is valence band in p region of PN junction. And here also we have, in this case also we have conduction band and valence band, but they are lower than P region. And when no voltage is supplied in depletion layer, we don't have any charge carriers. But when we forward bias our PN junction, if you look at the second figure, when we forward bias it, we can make out that electrons from N region, they'll go towards depletion layer. Holes from P region, they'll also go towards depletion layer. And we have recombination of electron hole pairs. And during recombination, energy is released in the form of light. Now, you people may wonder that, of course, now we came to know that why LEDs will glow. One more point, what we have to understand here is, we have different types of LEDs which will glow with different colors. So how we are able to get different colors of LED? So answer to that question, we can make out from this particular table. So completely color of LED, what light it is glowing, it depends upon what type of material we are selecting in order to make light emitting diode. So if we see here, of course we said that in direct band gap semiconductors or compound semiconductors which are used to make this particular light emitting diode, here forbidden energy gap, it is equal to h nu. So this forbidden energy gap is equal to h nu, which is ec by lambda. We know that frequency nu, it can be written in terms of a wavelength as hc by lambda. And here we can make out that wavelength of light being emitted from light emitting diode. So wavelength of light coming out from this LED, it depends upon Eg. And this Eg factor, it depends upon what type of material is used in order to make a LED. And we have seen that we can have different types of compound or direct band gap semiconductors by it depends upon which elements you are taking in order to make compound semiconductors. So we can go for a combination of third, fifth, or we can go for combination of second, sixth, or we can go for combination of two different elements coming from same group, that is fourth group. So here there is a table which will show us different colors related to different materials used in order to make a light emitting diode. So here we have, suppose if a material used in order to make PN junction diode of this LED is gallium arsenide, then that particular LED, it will glow. What is the color? Color is infrared. So here that color also you can see in this tabular column. This is the color coming out of light emitting diode. Whereas if I select material which belongs to gallium arsenic phosphide, here we are combining three different elements. And of course, here we have mentioned wavelength also. So what is the color being displaced, like displayed by LED? It is red in color. And what is the wavelength? 630 to 660 nanometer. And here also we have this forward voltage or threshold voltage also at which we have emission of light. So what exactly is this column? It, if I go for 1.2 volts of forward voltage, then our LED will start glowing for this material. So even if I make a light emitting diode with this material, what is this material? Gallium arsenic phosphide. In order to make this particular LED glow, I have to go to 2 volts. So I have to apply 2 volts. And what is the color displayed by that particular LED? Amber color. And here also we can see that amber color. And if for this combination of material, I have to go to this much of voltage in order to make that LED glow with yellow color. And here, of course, we are mentioning even wavelength also. And then we have for green color and then blue color. And also we have LEDs which are displaying white color also. Further, we have to make use of this combination of elements. So depending upon what type of material or what type of combinations we are using in order to make LED, those LEDs, they are going to display with different colors and they will be differing in their voltage. Okay, so there is one certain voltage at which your LED will start glowing. So these are the different voltages for different LEDs at which those LEDs will start glowing. So I hope like I'm able to present how exactly LED is going to work and what exactly how to make LED, what is the basic principle behind working of LED, and also we have explained it using energy band diagram. So with this, I'm going to end my session here. Thank you.
Like, share and subscribe. Hit the bell icon for more updates.